about the Liverpool City Region Raceway Improvement Plan. Just by way of a little bit of background, he's been around since 2000 really. It was something called a piece of legislation called the Countryside and Right-of-Way Act in 2000 that placed a statutory duty on all local highway authorities to prepare a right-of-way improvement plan and for that to be incorporated into local transport planning. So when we developed the second round of local transport plans in 2008, that was the time that the railway had to be put into that. And I have a 10-year time frame, so over the 10 years from 2008, what specifically is going to be done on a network of footpaths and right of way for walkers, for cyclists, for horse riders. And including the initial plan, it was about assessing the needs of what we wanted our right of way to do. And the landscape in 2008 is very different from the landscape in which we operate now. And governments have now come to further recognise the role of right-of-way can have in improving access to opportunities. So right-of-way isn't necessarily a transport issue. It's about the access issue for me. And it's about how people can access those opportunities and services that they require to improve their quality of life. So currently, in terms of context, we have two right-of-way for the Liverpool City region. We have the Merseyside Right-of-Way plan that's developed in 2008 and actually also this year. And we also have a separate plan for Halton, which starts a year later in 2009 and will actually run out next year. There is a duty to review these plans every 10 years. And given the way that much has changed in the region, you know, the very fact that we are now a bare and combined authority, gives us an opportunity to take both of those plans together and create one right-of-way improvement plan for the city region. And what that allows us to do, it will allow us to fulfill our statutory duty, but also to perhaps significantly enhance the role of right-of-way that we haven't been before. Right-of-way intended to be a standalone tick box exercise, if you like. And if you were to do a straw poll in a room and say, how many people have actually heard of the right-of-way improvement plan? You know, not many people would put their hands up and say that's something that they are fully aware of, even though they're statutory bound to produce one of these for our local planning authorities. We also need to take the view as well that last year the government released their cycling and walking investment strategy. Their stated aim to double the levels of walking and cycling by 2040. And that's going to put increasing demands on the local highway network, but it's also going to put increasing demands on our right-of-way network. And how do we utilise what is very much an underused resource at the moment to help us affect that change? So one of the things that we will have to do is we will have to measure this. It's a national target for walking and cycling, and as a city region, we will need to measure our progress against that. So, reviewing the plan, we need to do this review every 10 years. So, one of the first things that we have to do is establish whether statements of need, and statements of need is just right of way language for saying this is what we're going to do. So, the statements of need in the original plan, and there were lots of them, we've now distilled those down into 8 distinct areas, and they're set out in the plan. We also have to look at any updates from the policy section from 10 years ago. So that has changed quite significantly, and we have to create that policy section there. And I think more importantly, it's about taking right-of-way and saying, well, actually, it's not always about the transport issue. It's about how right-of-way link into lots of other things so we can raise its profile. And things there, we've got the local journey strategy, which you know members have had the presentation to about previously. We've got the Merseyside, which includes Halton as well, road safety strategy. And we've all got something which is starting to emerge now called the local cycling and walking investment plan, which is something that we're not duty bound to produce as a byproduct of the cycling and walking investment strategy. But it's one of those things that if you don't have it, you are less likely to have funding in the future. So that's a piece of work that we're working on now. And they're probably the two key mechanisms for delivering rights of way and how rights of way can contribute to both of those. And again, the road tends to have a 10-year time frame, but why? Why should it be a 10-year document? why could we make it much more life documents, achievable objectives that respond to the needs of residents across the city region. So again, going to developing the plan. Previously we had dedicated resources to do this. This time round, in reflection of where we find ourselves financially, we've taken this in-house. Subsequent savings to the combined authority of £60,000, where otherwise we may have brought in some external support to develop the plan. So we've coordinated with the Mersey Travel, with representatives from each of the local authority, highway authorities, to develop the plan. And what this allows us to do, perhaps, is maximise the benefits of the plan much better at the local level, so we can actually deliver what we want to deliver as a city region, rather than something that, in the longer term, is unrealistic and can't be achieved. And so we come to the plan's implementation. If you look through the document, we set out a number of plans, the short-term, the long-term, and the medium term. We've also got some committed schemes in there. They're primarily delivered through the Sustainable Transport Enhancements Package, of where there's a direct impact and influence with the existing right-of-way network. We currently have in the region of about 617 kilometres of right-of-way across the city region. So the schemes that we're delivering through the STEP programme will put some new ones in, but will also significantly enhance the existing infrastructure. And again, I've already mentioned we've got the action plan to develop. A lot of the stuff is aspirational, but that doesn't mean to say that it should be in there. Why should we not aspire to have the best right-of-way network that we can possibly deliver? You know, we're only limited by the scope of our own aspirations. So to a certain extent, leave the money off the table. If we have a blank check, what would we want to deliver? And that's what we aspire to in the revised plan. It's also about monitoring and evaluation. I think one of the weaknesses of the first row is we didn't effectively monitor the outcomes of what we did in terms of rights of way. So if we bring in a piece of infrastructure in, what has been the impact? How many more people have they got riding bikes or walking? How has that improved access to doctors, surgeries, to schools, to workplaces, to local shops and amenities? I think that's a weakness in the process that we have with the current row. And for me, it's all about evidence, evidence, evidence. If we're going to attract funding in the future to deliver this, we have to be able to demonstrate the business case. We heard Laura talking about presenting an outline business case for work the bus. The same equally applies for right of way and other things that we need to do. So what we've got in there is just a snapshot of some of the potential actions. So you can see a range of different programs ranging from at the top there, using the right of way network to improve access to major housing developments in Knowsley, just under £2 million. It's a really quite small scale schemes of around about £3,000, which in itself don't sound an awful lot. If we deliver that, we have multiple benefits, multiple outcomes across a range of different levels. So why do we need to collect the evidence? Why do we need to build the business case? There's no specific funding for right of way. There's no competition with every other transport priority across the city region. Prioritisation process is very, very important because we need to be able to put our limited funding into those schemes that can deliver the best value for money for the city region. And right-of-way, unfortunately, on their own, are not going to score highly enough at the moment because they don't link to other things. And if you take recent issues that have been raised by the equestrian lobby where they've said, perhaps what we want is not sufficient. Given high enough profile within the road safety strategy or within the right of way. It's like lots of things. You go through a prioritisation process that's not necessarily in favour of certain schemes. And we need to be able to say the right of way, you know, for some schemes are relatively cheap to implement, but they can deliver really quite good benefits for the city region. And this takes me back to the evidence, 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 the monitoring and evaluation, but if you're not being particularly as in the past, and I think this is one of the issues that needs to be talked about in the members' workshop at the end of January, beginning of February. We're going to talk about lots of issues in relation to the local change strategy, and I think this must be part of it. So what I've got here is just a series of slides that just takes everything I've just said and distills it into a series of diagrams. So where I think right of way needs to sit to help us deliver everything up at the top there, so we've got our key stakeholders, we have a 12-week consultation period on this right of way, so all of those comments have been incorporated and helps develop the plan. But you see, the plan there links into cycling and walking, the local authority priorities, feeding through into the local journey strategy, then up to that kind of city region level, linking to visitor economy, the housing strategy, the local transport plan, and other plans and priorities. At the more local level, I said it's not just about transport, and again, this is not an exhaustive list by any stretch of the imagination, just an illustration to show you how right of way can help deliver across multiple objectives and multiple partners. So, say, health and well-being there, we can get more people onto our right of way network. They're walking and cycling, they're getting fitter, we're starting to address obesity problems, we're starting to improve mental health, we're starting to improve air quality, and you can then start to see the benefits roll out. And this slide here just takes the 54-page document that you've got and distills it into one slide. And it works as a little bit of a logic map, if you like. So what we've got over here is, this is the aim of the right of way plan. The context, the three priorities are set out in the transport plan for growth. Our wider city region strategic priorities. These are the eight statements of action that I talked about earlier. They've been distilled down from about 25 into 8 to give the plan a real focus. The actions that we want to develop, how we're going to do that, and again, what are the outcomes that we want to achieve through our right of way improvement plan. And just to finish things off by way of illustration, and this is not a case of any one earlier, but this is Seth in the right of way network. If you didn't know what that was, that would be completely meaningless to you because it just looks like lots of lines on a map. So if you think in the context of the first right of way plan that's just about to run out, that's where that's at. It puts the formula for that for funding, and people would go, well, what does that do? It doesn't actually do anything. It doesn't actually tell me anything. You start to build up your evidence base, and you can see on this one, so the blue there, you've got the tourism sites on the Southern Coast. You've got the orange blocks there are the major housing developments, the red are the main employment sites. If you then start to add on the rail network, the key loop network, you can see how the right of way is kind of the glue that kind of starts to link all of these together. And you can see how the right of way improvement plan, if we maintain the network and put even the structure in place, can actually have an important role to play in improving access to opportunities and services. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Well, it's nice to bring in that all to life, so that was really, really useful. I'm sure there will be quite a few questions, so I'll take Mary, then Gordon, Jerry, then John, then Jeff.
John, that was really interesting. Now, forgive my ignorance, but I'm looking at funding streams and I'm thinking everything you're telling me there about the grants, about health benefits from it, you know, getting people back out there. How does that fit in all 6 months in new developments? Because to me, if I was spending it locally, I'd be looking at the things that's mentioned specifically in Garston and thinking that fits with the 106. So,
it does, and it's about a selling job, isn't it? You know, it goes back to this thing, we haven't always sold the right of way improvement plan as benefit to new housing. You know, why should we not be going to developers and saying, if you're building a new housing development there, we could look at you to put the right cycle and pedestrian infrastructure in place.
Thank you very much for the report. It's very extensive, and I'm glad to see that within that we've got a nice tight EIA section. I'm not sure if I've missed a part of this, but when we're making accessibility for these paths, is to improve the surface for the types of users. There's two users, might be maybe you've consulted them on, I just don't know. Two types of users. I'm sure the chair will be very interested in one time. It'll be those that go pushing a fan. And I think yes. I can't see any ear to people now. And right to the other side of the scale, those ones who are on the motorised scooters. Is there a gap there or a virus there?
It's not a gap, it's like anything, isn't it? You go into chapter and verse and the plan that you've got when we first crafted it, it was the thick end of the pages. And you know, to have a document that big is not great for everyone, particularly because it's in the domain. So we've taken an awful lot of that detail out and we put that in the appendix. One of the things I will say, and this alludes to the, I call it the LCWIC. I hate talking in acronyms, but it's just easy to say that than local cycling and walking infrastructure plan, which is a bit of a mouthful. One of the things that we're going to do, and one of the things that we have got, we've secured 80 days of free support from the Department of Transport to help us develop our LCWIC, which we have to match with a similar number of support from offices across the city region and all the way from Frankfurt to right down to office 11. And we've been negotiating with PFT for some time, and our LCWIC, there's going to be three tranches, and our LCWIC is going to be in the first tranche, the ones that were used nationally, so ours will be available in the summer of this year, which is really good for us. One of the things that we're going to do as part of that plan is we're going to have a Liverpool City Region design guide for walking and cycling infrastructure that's going to be specific to the city region. If you look elsewhere around the country, it tends to be a cycling design guide. We're going that one step further and saying, again, alluding to the local journey strategy, it's not about the mode, it's about the journey. And because we commit ourselves to having a key route network for walking and cycling, we want that to be the highest possible quality that it can be, and that's where we address the needs of different users of the network.
Jerry?
Yeah, just to make a quick comment. Yeah, it takes slightly longer as a runner. The main numbers of service users are runners, but there's no mention to runners, it's just cyclists and walkers.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a casual phrase, unfortunately. If he wants us to expand that slightly to encourage other users, then I'm more than happy to reflect that in the wider document. I mean, we don't specifically mention horse riders, for example, which perhaps you should do.
Yes.
Yeah,
okay, John, then Jet, then Alan.
Thanks, Joe. Thanks, Will. Thank you very much for your comprehensive presentation as well. Just have some concern about one aspect of it, really. Lower on in the report on page 58, you talk about the right-of-way improvements projects, and they are listed district by district. Now, they read at the moment, excuse me for using this phrase, but they read at the moment something a bit like a wish list, really.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering whether it becomes a strategy that we can transform into action by prioritising specific projects within a given time frame. Short, medium, and long term are not really helpful to members. That doesn't really mean anything. You know, short term in terms of the age of the planet is a few billion years. Long term is billions. You know, we're talking 3 months, 6 months, 12 months. You know, whatever. You get my general point. It would be much more helpful if they had specific time frames associated with them, and also in terms of the way they prioritise for members right across it. So they're actually itemised by district, which is very helpful.
Yeah.
But what is not helpful is the rest of the information. Quite frankly.
I agree. I think that's a piece of work that needs to be done. There's a loose an issue that we've had as a group. At the moment, the way right-of-way work is that each local authority is responsible for securing a local area. And I question, is that the right mechanism for taking this forward, given the fact that we're aligning this to things like the local journey strategy, where we're looking to take a more centralised approach to delivery. Do you want to do the same thing with right of way? And I think that fits more easily with what Will suggested in terms of doing it as a wider prioritisation exercise across the city region. And I think that's something that I'm certainly looking for some further advice from. I'm going to be taking that back to my tag members to see if they want to see about that.
Just a quick comment, if I may.
I mean,
this is to be represented, and I hope it will be. I think what I'm asking for really is, I think colleagues would probably agree, is some sort of presentation of the time frame. So I think that would be helpful. Thank you.
I think to be sort of helpful as well, with that, obviously we're going to be having a workshop, as you rightly pointed out, with John in next month, looking at the local sustainable journeys implementation of that. And obviously that could probably naturally dovetail with this as well. Yeah, of course you can.
I think the reality is set out the way it is. John's alluded to the fact that the fund isn't guaranteed. We don't really know where the money's coming from. And it is an aspirational programme. We can use some of the money there. But it's difficult for the very reason that we don't know where the funding will be, certainly in a few years from now, to give absolute assurance that these schemes will be delivered at any particular point in time. I mean, John's right in saying that the group has struggled with this. You know, it has been discussed on a number of occasions as to how meaningful those sorts of comments are. But it is very difficult, especially in the current funding regime, to know exactly when this will be available. John's right in saying that we will, if we can provide any kind of assurance, we will do and we can do it as soon as we can, if that helps.
Jeff. Thanks, Chair. Once again, if you go to page 56, I know you don't put in these reports, you can't be putting supply for water authority, but it's one that particularly says the footbridge across the Liverpool Manchester rail line to connect Wimbledon Rocks residential area with land currently occupied by Widnes Golf Club. Now, that may not seem a big deal to a lot of people in this room, but there's been so much rumour and speculation, there's a petition going locally about stopping houses being built on Widnes Golf Club, which fits nicely into Mary's point, which was about 106 million, because in the document, when it says costing, it says NA. So it's just unfortunately written, really, the way it is. I don't know who's responsible for putting it in, but if it's going to go out, it needs a little bit of carefully wording rather than what it is clumsily wording.
Point well made, absolutely. I think the intention is, you're probably aware of this, is not necessarily to take down anything into the golf course, it's not for the golf course, it is to allow the public on the north side of the railway to get access, so they can come out to the likes of Birchfield Road and that sort of area. So you're probably correct in that the word is to be changed by it.
Al? Yeah, thanks. You mentioned about off-riding the GSM perhaps, that should be included. There's no perhaps about it. It has got to be included. I mean, you know, there was a couple of months ago a great big lobby about that here. And where I am, before 100 horses, stable in Mainfield. We have our own right of way in the linear park, and it's great for the horse riders, and horse riders, walkers, the cyclists, they all mix together well. Apart from one man whose house backs on to the linear park, phoned me up and said, I can hear horses at the bottom of my yard. And I said, yes. I don't want to hear horses at the bottom of my yard. And I said, well, you'd better change your house then. And he said, lose 400 houses and he doesn't want to, 400 horses and he doesn't want to hear horses. So yeah, can I leave that one?
I didn't allude to it in the presentation, but I can assure you that horse riders are included.
Thank you very much.
Patrick. Thank you, Chair. I was going to mention neighbourhood planning, but as the discussion has developed, I think what I want to do is raise top level and talk about local plans. Colleagues are probably aware that through planning law, what's happening now, each local authority is having to come up with a 15-year local plan. Now, enshrined within that is what it says on the tip. You should plan for anything. For example, in Sefton, part of the one of the objectives is to develop green pathways, develop green corridors, develop cycle paths, pedestrian routeways. The funding for that has been identified as coming from developer contributions, otherwise known as 106. So it would answer the question you were asking. If it was done on a strategic level, the natural home for this, which I think is a good document, by the way, it's very comprehensive, would sit within local authority, local plans. So in terms of influencing what's going on,
within local plans, it may be a bit late in some respects, but you may be able to fit what you're trying to do in here into local 15-year local plans, and that's where you get funding from. But from a personal point of view, I'm involved in McGull. We've got a key asset going through the middle of McGull, and that's the leads to the McGull Canal, which is a 70-mile public way. Well, I don't know if it's a public right-of-way, but it's a, you can ride a bike for 70 miles on and all that. Within this, I think it could be improved by looking at how the leads to Liverpool Canal, could be linked up to all their pedestrian and cycleways. And even more importantly, from our point of view, as a town council, we are about to put out to a referendum a neighbourhood plan, which is part of the 2011 Localism Act, which gives us planning powers. Within that, we've got our own plan for improving cycleways, railways, and how we link into the canal. And it's just a shame that, and I'm not criticising anyone, but that level of planning detail that's going on within neighbourhood plans and local plans, this should sit within those key planning documents, I would suggest.
I mean, I'll speak for my old representative Holden, and we certainly take into account the public right-of-way network in any local plans. And as we've mentioned earlier, certainly in terms of getting any money from a developer, we do that. I'm sure that your borough is doing the same. But if you, like I say, your point, Councillor, it's an important thing that we press developers to get as much as we can for these schemes.
Fits it in the local plan.
Yeah, but I say, I'll speak for my own group at the moment, it does.
Okay, I've got John and then Steve.
My ward is fairly rural on the east side of Rockwell, and it contains villages of Gardner in science technology areas. So it's on and Bridgewater Canal. Although we've got some, being a rural area like that, we get lots of walkers and everything else. But as far as the canals are concerned, all my people holdings, they never seem to cooperate with local organisations, parish councils, sometimes the council. And I wonder if the Peel Holdings have taken any part in this project and are willing to join in it anyway. They're just a law to themselves, aren't they?
I think Councillor Bradshaw knows my views on that, what he's saying, because we have found it extremely difficult to make a deal in doing any work on a lot of our rights of way and doing it at all times. And it is unfortunate, and despite what pressure we're trying to put on them. That said, we'll continue to try and get them to import as best we can, but there's certainly no guarantee of success there.
Steve?
Yeah, I just read the word aspirational, and we've also heard the phrase a wish list. My problem with the document is that, not a problem, I prefer to go with aspirational. That's a bit more positive statement, but as we see, the sort of the numbers we're looking at will outstretch the 10-year plan and beyond, to be frankly honest. So there needs to be a dose of realism somewhere in the statements of the plan that it is aspirational, because already some of us fell into the trap of looking at schemes and saying, oh, well, that's a real life scheme. Well, in the reality of things, about 99% of those schemes will never see light or day or ever get anywhere near. So if each authority perhaps could come up with one or two of its key priorities, would be a good start. But I think we need to get away from raising expectations of the public that there's bags of money there, because if you look on page 47, that's where the funding money is coming from. You don't know any one of those budget headings or pots of money that isn't under stress, particularly EU funding, as we're leaving the EU. So, I think we have to be realistic with the public as well. So it is aspirational. And if we have lots of money to spend, we do a lot more, but we just need to get that dose of years in the government.
Absolutely. seat. Tony?
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, John. I think what's being mentioned about the local plans and neighbour plans, and obviously to fund some of these projects, it will be down to development 106 community infrastructure levies and so on and so forth. The typical thing about the past has been developers tend to say, well, it's going to take some of our profits away, so we can't do this and we can't do that. I find that the other reason not to actually put any back into the community and take much as much as we can out of their developments. But I believe this scrutiny committee for providing authority. I've been looking at the spatial strategy for the open city region. Whilst this document covers the whole of the city region and the spatial strategy plan, the combined authority overrides all of the local plans anyway, then there should be some statutory obligation for developers, wherever they may be, on settlement, wherever, to make a contribution to some of these projects, so that there is a guarantee that there is something that comes back in, and developers won't go to a planning authority and say, sorry, we haven't made an obligation to do that. But under the city region, there might be an obligation and statutory responsibility to basically fulfill some of these before they take the money and run.
I think that's certainly a possibility. Using the 106 arrangement, even if, I suppose in a way it's down to each authority how severe they want to be with the developer, because you're quite right. There are been instances where if we've been too severe, we threaten to move to another district or even to another region, which is the last thing that we want. And often it's a situation of a compromise developing as to how much we can actually get out of developing. But I think. If each local authority were preferred to stick to the government, say we want this in this part, you're probably aware there are certain flexibilities with 106. We can be specific and say, right, we want a new footpath from A to B, or we can say we want so many tens or hundreds of thousands of pounds towards transport improvements across the borough. Depending on who you're dealing with, they might agree to it, they might not do it, they might want to be more specific, they must know as to what they think. I think there is the flexibility there for us to be specific, to demand money, you can put it that way, for a particular public right to make improvement. I'm sure the district officer would do that as and when they can. Yeah.
I think that's been really useful. If I can then sort of move the recommendation in paragraph 2 of the report, and that's agreed. Excellent. Item 7 is public questions. We have received a couple of questions from Grace, that's addressed to Council 3. Asking about Mr. Grace, one of the microphones. Can you? Oh, we've got one there. Just see if you can ask your questions, John.
Yeah, do you want me to ask
them
together or ask them
separately?
Yeah,
separately.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, if you ask the first and then the second one, because then we can do it in the board.
Happy New Year. As the lead member for Rail and Freight, I'm sure you're aware of the recent strikes of the past year by the RMT Union on the Merseyrail train network about the introduction of new trains that's rolling stock on the Merseyrail network. The decisions to go for new rolling stock were made at the Mersey Travel Committee meeting and the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority meeting, both held on the 16th of December 2016. At some point in the future, both Merseyrail and Merseytravel have decided that cars are not required on the new trains. Can you please explain the reasons why this change has been decided and what's the plan to happen to those who are coming to the start?
Thanks very much, John, and a very merry and happy new year to you and I'm assuming the first paragraph isn't the question, it's just the preamble to get to the point where we're asking that, because they're factually. What I would say is, it's a bit difficult in giving a response that answers everything, so I'm just trying to briefly encapsulate what the difference is, because we did have a presentation before in which Aviva North put forward to me, and I'd actually moved a motion to retain the guards on the SSU.
when I was looking at positions here, I was asked to not look at the generic situation, but look what applied to our amazing network. And you look at that, and you look at what are the changes that are being brought forward by new technology and by the design of the trains. The first thing was, and the main thing for us, was the gap between the train and the platform train interface. And that was addressed by a plate that was to be moved forward, and that would give access to disabled people that currently have to rely on customer service staff to help them. The profile of the train was changed, and that was to address the issues that happened with James Street service. In asking all the questions of those, there was nothing that I found was an answer. And I think the directors and many of the officers of Maisie Trouble, and probably a lot of my colleagues, found it very, very difficult, time that was taken to be persuaded of those back to the gardeners were very great and very arduous. We also knew whatever decision we were going to be making was going to be scrutinised by everyone. And so it was important, not just for ourselves and everyone else around, but also for our party and everyone to see that we were making the right decision. Not an easy decision, but a right decision.
Obviously,
that's what's important.
Obviously.
I'll just continue. Okay? Absolutely critically to be looked at was those issues about how we preserve the safety and the security of people who are using the train. When we'd address the issues about the platform interface, it then became an issue regarding the doors. There's a leading edge technology on the doors, and I think very importantly, which maybe a lot of people haven't been able to understand this, we have a different system of audio visual way of addressing things. So that people look at a camera, they will see the picture of themselves. The carriages are open as one unit, very bright and visible. They'll see through that. And if anything does arise, you think that is in communication with the driver and with the central control center. What's important about that is the fact our network is so different that you only have to go at an average of about 4 minutes from a station to the next. Whatever's going to be happening, it's going to be notified to that station next, and there will be someone, because all our stations are staffed, unlike the majority around there. So we're investing in a new rolling stock that will have a level walk-off from the train to the platform. That's not been easy to achieve, because the infrastructure that we have is very old, and it's a legacy that we got from the past. That means we're investing a lot in changing the profile of that platform so this system will work. And achieving all that and going beyond that, what we're also doing, guaranteeing everyone a job, everyone their pay, and all their conditions. And all I can say is that in line with other colleagues, who've raised these issues time and time again across the region, I'd implore all sides, Chair, in this issue, to get together and get through discussions. Having an industrial action for something, and we're still 2 years away from anywhere coming to this, is not in everyone's interest. I think there's a room for discussion on this, and I welcome the comments that Mr. Dan Carden made. I know that will go on to the second part of your question.
Yes, I do have a supplementary question to follow up. I will just say the improvements to the platform train interface are much welcome, especially for my wife who struggles on and off the train. On the 22nd of November 2017, there was an adjournment debate in House of Commons on guards on Merseyrail trains, which could be read in hindsight. I won't read out the links, it's quite long. Mayor's Travel and the Liverpool City Meeting Combined Authority were both referred to during that debate. Would you like to respond specifically to the comments made by the Parliamentary Under-Secretary of State for Transport, Paul Maynard, about guards on Merseyrail trains during the course of the debate?
Well, I think if they gave a short answer, they'd say no.
The position for myself on this one is it has nothing to do with our network. I quite like you said that. The debate that did go on was very interesting to me. I think he was quite honest with his point of view that he has on those issues. He articulated them from his political point of view. We articulated ours from our political point of view. And I think it ended up that we can all agree that we disagree. I don't think there's any, if there's anything I've missed on that, just tell me now.
I don't have any more questions left, so I can't ask you anymore.
You can ask me.
Okay, thanks very much for that, and I hope that's a bit helpful, John. Eight is position statement, but we haven't received any positions or statements. And nine is any other urgent business approved by the chair. Because of sort of Christmas and the sort of time scales around Christmas, have allowed a report that's been circulated with regard to air quality and a public consultation deadline that we need to meet. So Hugh is here, who's going to be able to present the report accordingly.
Thanks very much, Chair. Happy New Year to everyone. I will be very brief with this, so I'll just quickly counter through the main points. Firstly, grateful for the opportunity to table this late item. It's an important issue and one that we consider very important to take through members before we take our response back to government's closing date is tomorrow. In a nutshell, the consultation concerns the government's proposal to tackle poor air quality, typically caused by nitrogen dioxide, which comes from diesel vehicles in the main. And what this response sets out is a Liverpool City Region position. As members will know, we have a severe air quality problem in the Liverpool City Region. We have 11 air quality management areas, and the health risks have been drawn out previously. It's typically a transport problem because it stems from motorised transport in the main rather than industry or weather conditions, for example. And it's a serious long-standing problem, and probably for the best part of 15 years, it goes right back to our devolution deal from a few years ago. So there is a long-standing commitment there to tackle the issue. Governments have been producing a number of plans to set out their approach for how they will deal with this problem to ultimately meet European targets, European emission targets of compliance by 2020. What the government recognised through this consultation is that some of the measures that are at stake to tackle poor air quality through transport could have a big impact on people's lives. It could have a big impact on people's pockets. So if you look at some of the potential measures being looked at nationally, things like clean air zones, which could entail, we've got an example in London now, the T-zone, whereby people with older vehicles or polluting vehicles pay a fee to enter that area. Government recognise that, in addition to the air quality benefits, there could be disbenefits and air quality issues for people as a result of having to pay higher fees. Equally, the potential there to introduce a scrappage scheme for diesel vehicles, that brings around some big issues of equity as well. So the government launched this consultation at the end of November, principally aimed at gathering evidence on these potential measures, but perhaps more importantly, more significantly, it was to wrap the issue up with the Clean Air Fund, that